Now, so the precession, okay, the precession is the usual rule, no? We have to convert the precession axis, which is the third inertial axis, into the body frame, no? So we have to use the inverse transformation from body to inertial, which is x minus theta h and z minus psi 2. And this is the result. Now, consider the third component. The third component, no, is this one. Because we have omega sub 3 equal to psi 2 dot plus psi 1 dot cos theta h plus omega 3. So omega 3 is constant, cos theta h is constant. Now we have to see which is psi 1 dot. So we have to prove that psi 1 dot is constant. If psi 1 dot is constant, then of course also the psi 2 dot is constant. But now, using the first two components and building up the square, no? The first two components, the square is psi 1 dot square times the square of the sine of the notation angle, and this is equal to omega 1 square plus omega 2 square. But omega 1 square plus omega 2 square is constant. So all the three angular rate defined in this way are constant. So in practice we have, remember, the body frame, the rotation around the body, the third axis is constant, and the spin rate, because we assumed it was constant. Second, the angular rate vector is constant in magnitude, but is not constant in direction, and we will build the construction also in the inertial frame. And then we have the angular momentum, which is inertial and is constant, of course. Questions? Of course, this is a geometric point of view. This was a very useful one when, of course, the computer were not did not exist, but now, of course, we can verify all this result using the numerical simulation. So, at the end, the spin rate psi dot 2, no? No, not omega 3 0 is the spin rate, can be written using the equation that we found as the composition of the psi dot 2, which is not the spin rate but is the nutation rate, psi dot 2, which is equal to capital omega, plus psi 1 dot, which is the precession rate, times the cosine of the nutation angle. And the nutation angle has been defined in this way. Questions? Remember that the nutation rate is a sine, which depends whether the spin, the inertia moment on the spin axis and the other two inertia moment which is the greater of these two inertia moments, no? Flat and yes, disc flat and slim body. And so, depending on the S, we have these two cases. In the case of the slim body, S is greater than zero, and so precession and spin have equal direction, which is called the direct precession. Instead, for a flat body, we have the retrograde precession. So the precession and spin have different signs. This part, this is not in your handouts, but I will, of course, post in the. This is just to complete the picture and to compute the components of the angular rate in order to clarify also the angular rate in the inertial frame. But it should be clear from the initial construction at the end of the Euler dynamic study that the angular rate vector does not coincide with the inertial vector. So it means that the angular rate vector is constant in magnitude, but is not constant in direction. And so this can be, no, obtained by combining together, no, the different rotation vector. Now we have to use the inverse transformation because we want to obtain, no, the angular rate in the inertial frame. No, before we wanted to obtain the angular rate in the body frame and now in the inertial frame. So the precession is just 001 times psi dot 1. Instead, the nutation rate we have to convert, no, through x theta h and z psi 1. And so we are obtaining this expression, no? We have the composition of the precession rate and the nutation rate, and you see that the nutation rate, of course, is multiplied time sine psi 1 and cos psi 1, which is the precession, and so they are rotating, of course, around the angular momentum. The next results, the simulation, you can course make the next simulation using the script and model that you have in your hands. Unfortunately, I cannot do it now in real time because of my computer, which is out of work. And unfortunately, it's not a simple out of work. Because we tried twice to recover, but we didn't succeed. So be careful that probably there are some corrections to be done in the handouts, but now we can see. So start from a flat body. No, flat body means that the third inertia moment is larger than the inertia moment of first and second axis. We are adopting, now we are restricting to the axis symmetric case because the two inertia moments are equal, J1 equal to J2. Then we adopt this initial angular rate. Probably in your handout this is 0.002 change into 0.005 because the result should correspond to this value and also this date. Remember that remember that the mutation rate, no, depends on the parameter sigma. The parameter sigma is the difference between the inertia moment divided the inertia moment. And remember that sigma is between minus 1 and 1. The degenerate case occurs when sigma is plus or minus 1. So usually, no, in order not to be in this case, we must pay attention, no? Indeed, you see, the third inertia moment is not equal to twice J1, which pro will provi would provide, no, the degenerate case. So, free response, so omega now, this is the capital omega, no, the nutation rate, and we can compute, this is negative, because we are in the flat body case. This is the angular rate, no, in practice is no, close to the spin. There is a small difference because no, the second inertia moment is not just twice the other two moments. This is the angle of the this is the angle, no, gamma sub omega is the angle between the angular rate and the spin axis, no? Remember the angular rate, the cone is the body cone. And theta h is the nutation angle. Now, if we are restricting now, these results were already seen, but no, we see that the spin rate is constant, and instead the other two rate are oscillating with a period no determined by the nutation rate. So the period is 140 seconds, and you see that the period is pretty equal to about 140 seconds. This is the other case in which we have a slim body. So now the third axis, no? The spin axis has a smaller mo moment of inertia with respect to the other two axes, no? So in practice, no, we have a slim body. This is rather usual, okay? And we have the same initial angular rate. Now the nutation rate changes, becomes half of the spin rate, and now the period, of course, becomes the double. So be careful that the picture in your handout is not correct. I had no time to introduce, because my computer is out of work, to correct and put the correct picture. It seems, if I remember, the period of the picture on your handout is always 140 seconds, so probably is concerned the other case. And here in the picture you have the two body cones, the two cones, the body cone and the angular momentum cone around the spin axis. This is the geometric point of view. Now we are trying to, I try to explain the solution of the overall equation, no? Because up to now, in the previous simulation, we are only seeing the nutation rate, so the evolution in time of the angular rate. Now we want to see also the evolution in time of the attitude. It's clear? Of course, now the total equation becomes of sixth order, okay? So now try to build up the total equation. We start from the nonlinear representation, and then we simplify, no, to study the perturbation of a spin motion. We will use the standard 3-2-1 sequence. Now, of course, we have to remind, no, this complicated kinematic equations, no? So, of course, be careful. This way of writing the equation is not correct, because this is not a linear equation. So we cannot write this equation using matrices. So be careful, warning. But to have a compact form, no? In the first, in the position 1-1 of the block matrix, of the state block matrix, I just put zero, which is actually is not true. We shall see when we will obtain the perturbation equation, there are some values here. But up to now, we can just write, no, the nonlinear part, the nonlinear equation, which is connecting, no, the Euler angles, only two Euler angles, no, phi and theta, no, roll and pitch, to the three angular rate components in the body frame. Remember, no, angular rate in the body frame. Instead, the dynamic part, no, the Euler dynamics, is simpler, because we are in the axis in metric case, and this is already very close to be linear, but be careful, no? Also, this is non-linear, because here we have omega 3, and here we have omega 2, and so on. So we have now to develop the perturbation equation around some equilibrium point or trajectory. Just to complete the picture, remember the matrix B, no? The matrix B, the upper matrix is completely zero, which means this, which means that the torque is not acting directly on the attitude. The torque is acting directly only on the angular rate. So this is the generalization of the Newton equation, no? Remember this very simple but fundamental concept, no? The cause of the motion are forces or moment of forces, and the cause, no, of the motion does not act directly on the position or on the attitude. In order to find out the relation between the causes of the motion, forces and torques, we have to introduce a cascade of two integrators that in the 3D case, no, convert into six integrator, but practically, no, they are three, no, parallel of two integrator. This is a picture to have in mind. This is a fundamental of the motion, of a rigid body motion, of a point mass motion. Now, equilibrium. So, we are assuming a constant. Remember that any constant rate around the principal axis is an equilibrium. So, and also, no? So this means that the third component is assumed constant, but of course we can assume also some perturbation around omega sub 3. But this is the equilibrium, so it means that now the attitude is not constant, but there is a spin motion, and this is the equilibrium trajectory. This is a trajectory, it's not a point for the attitude. So we define the perturbations, theta minus theta underline, omega minus omega underline, denominal comma di zero, and we shall study now only the free response, so delta u, in any case, if you want to write also the complete perturbation equation, you can assume that the input perturbation is exactly equal to the input. Now, the perturbation equation of the kinematic equation and of the Euler dynamic equation have been already found. So now we have just to put together. And now we have collinear time invariant equations. No? It's very interesting that this linear time invariant equation is not very complicated. No? What points out? Points out two oscillator. And it's reasonable there are two oscillator. Because remember the geometric construction before, no? The geometric construction of the attitude for an axisymmetric case, free response, pointed out that there are two types of angular rate, no? The nutation rate and the precession rate. The precession rate is related to the attitude. So it means that we need two oscillator. So, this is the oscillator of the kinematic in which the natural frequency, natural angular frequency is exactly the spin rate. And then there are the other oscillator of the dynamic in which no, the natural angular rate is the so-called nutation rate. So in total we have six eigenvalues. And very important, no? This is the simplicity of this equation. The spin motion is completely decoupled, independent of the instead pitch and roll motion. No? You see, there is no connection. No? The connection, you see here is zero, this vector is zero. This vector is zero. Of course, this connection, this decoupling can be lost, maybe can be lost when we are introducing external torques. That may depend on the attitude and so on. Okay, so by introducing external torques, this simplicity, no, may be lost. So the spin motion has two eigenvalue equal to zero, no? You can immediately see because no, this matrix is an upper triangular matrix, so the eigenvalues can be found on the diagonal block matrices. It's clear. And instead, the other four eigenvalues are imaginary, no? Because we are in the axisymmetric case. We are now not eliminating the case in which the spin and also the spin, be careful, no, in the axisymmetric case, and the spin motion is around either the minimum or the maximum. But in the axisymmetric case, there is no intermediate moment of inertia. So the spin motion can only occur, no, around the minimum or maximum inertia axis. So in the axisymmetric case, we are always in the stable case. There is no intermediate axis. And these eigenvalues now are very well known. We have already computed several times. So now I think as an exercise in state equations, we try to compute the free response. And of course, it's possible then also compute the forced response. It is always very important as a methodology, no? Also when you are using sophisticated simulator, always parallel the simulation, the numerical simulation with analytic computation, in order to verify that the analytic computation and the numerical simulation matches each other, because errors are very easy to be done, okay, in computations. So the spin free response is very easy, no? This is a second order solution. So it's the cascade of two integrators. The cascade of two integrator, and this is also the forced response to be complete. Okay? So we are writing also the forced response. Remember, this is the perturbation. The free response corresponds to the physics uniform motion, because there is no acceleration, zero acceleration. Instead, the forced response means there is an acceleration. The acceleration is due to the torques acting on the third axis. So the first two components are the free response, no? Initial perturbation plus the perturbation delta omega 3,0 times t, plus, and this is the convolution integral. You should learn how to immediately understand the convolution integral. I don't know if this was explained in other courses. Why the convolution integral has this form? Integral between 0 and t of t minus tau times delta u3 of tau, which is the input perturbation, times delta tau. Why? Because the free response on the position, the free response of the position, due to the initial rate, is of this kind, t is ram. No? And this corrisponds to the matrix, to the exponential matrix, which is 0, pardon, 1 t 1 0. No, this is the uniform motion. So this is due to the uniform motion. But the convolution integral is nothing else than the combination of the free responses at any time. Okay? So this t minus tau is just the free response at times tau, multiplied times the, of course, the an initial condition, which is due to the current command or input delta u sub 3 of tau delta tau. That's very important. Otherwise, the convolution integral seems something very complicated, but it's nothing complicated. It's very simple. It's just a combination of free responses. So instead, in order to obtain the free response, the forced response of the transversal motion, so this is more complicated, but I already explained a very simple method. Since we have only two, we have two cascade oscillators, it's possible to replace each pair of state of the oscillator with just one complex variable. And so we can write Q, the new variable, as the combination of the roll perturbation and pitch perturbation. Delta omega was already defined, and so we can also define delta u. And then the equation becomes just a second order equation. A second order equation is similar to the spin motion equation, but this is complex. And we have two imaginary eigenvalues, no? Minus j times the spin rate and the nutation rate. And now it's not difficult to obtain the free response and the forced response. This is a very interesting exercise in solving state equations. Be careful, before I spoke of the degenerate case when sigma tends to 1. Why, when sigma tends to 1, the case has been called degenerate, I called degenerate case. Which is the reason? Look this equation, this state matrix. Which is the property of this state matrix when sigma tends to be 1? We have two imaginary eigenvalues and then two pairs of complex eigenvalues which become coincident. So in this case, the state equation is no more stable, as in the spin motion. The spin motion equation, no, 0, 1, 0, 0, is not stable. Also, the eigenvalues are on the imaginary axis, but the eigenvalues now are coincident. So be careful, when the eigenvalues are coincident, the stability is not a generic rule. We have to see case by case if it is stable or unstable. When there is instability, when the block diagram is a cascade of integrators. Indeed, the free response include a ramp, which is divergent. This is the same case, and this case is what is called in electronics the resonance. What means that one the it means that the oscillation of the dynamics is tuned on the oscillation rate of the kinematics, and so these two oscillations excite each other, and then the result is an increasing amplitude of the oscillation, the resonance. So we are assuming that sigma is not equal to 1, okay? It's between minus 1 and 1, so it's less than 1 in magnitude. Otherwise, we are in the unstable case. Here there are different cases, no? Or the simplest cases when sigma is equal to 0 is the spherical case, okay? In that case, we have only one oscillator, the kinematic oscillator. So now it's not difficult to solve the equation. When the equation are not so complicated as in this case, this can be solved, for instance, but using MATLAB symbolic, the symbolic MATLAB, passing, for instance, through the Laplace transform. The symbolic MATLAB, I suggest to make this exercise using the symbolic MATLAB. We are just in a second order case, so not difficult. Here also it's not difficult now. We have to invert this matrix, no? S time, no? S time I minus A, make the inversion, no? The determinant, of course, of this matrix is the characteristic polynomial. And so the inverse is of this kind. This is upper triangular and the inverse remains upper triangular. And on the diagonal, of course, we have the transfer function of each single, no, the two oscillator, okay, separated. In this case, first order, because we are adopting complex again, complex state variable, no? So this is very easy. And of course, in the upper diagonal, now the Laplace transform combines the two, is such to combine the two oscillations, no? And it is for this combination that when the angles are equal, that no, these two terms are equal, and so we have to consider the limit for sigma tending to zero, and then in the case of in the degenerate case by no anti-transform in this term, you see the anti-transform now is just the combination of two decreasing exponential, no? So, but in the no, decreasing, no, not decreasing because we are in the oscillation, okay, decreasing for what concern the imaginary part, so they are not decreasing, they are just sine and cosine, be careful. But if the angle, the omega 3 and the sigma omega 3 would be equal, this equation, no, as a limit for sigma tending to 1, makes a component, a drift, so a ramp to appear, and this justifies the instability. It's the same T that appears in the spin exponential, in the spin exponential matrix. When there are coincident eigenvalues in a cascade, try to study. This is very important for control, for dynamics. When there are coincident eigenvalues, the in the exponential matrix on the upper diagonal appear polynomials t, t squared, t cubic, and so on. And this justifies, means that they are becoming, of course, if these polynomials are multiplied time on exponential that is decreasing, converging to zero, you remember that the exponential is dominating, no? The polynomial, so the terms converges to zero. But if this polynomial is multiplied time on trigonometric function, then it diverges. As in this case, but now, of course, we are considering sigma different from one, and so, of course, we are in a stable case. No? But these terms, the difference between exponential, cosine, and sine, has another important meaning. So now we are in presence of two harmonic motion at different frequencies. So when you have harmonic motions at different frequencies, it's very important also to put in evidence, no, the difference between the two frequencies or the two angular frequencies. Because the difference, and we shall see, when you see the total motion, the combination, actually you are not, it's difficult to separate the two motions, the two singular motion, but sometimes you can see not the singular motion, but the difference of the motion, which is called the beat motion. And of course, you can also compute the forced response. So this equation is very important because put in evidence several types of responses in dynamic systems. Now, we want to see the result of the simulation. So we have to consider now to introduce the different periods of the three responses, the spin period, the nutation period, and I also define the beat motion. The beat motion corresponds as a frequency, which is the difference between the two frequencies, the spins and the nutation. Start by considering a slender body, a slim body, a slender body, the same. So now we have the spin motion as a frequency of 8 millihertz. 8 millihertz, so the period will be greater than 100 seconds. Frequencies and period are typical of spacecraft, okay? So the but on the spacecraft sometimes there are also faster higher frequencies, but frequencies of the order of 0.1 hertz or less, they are typical. So these values are not just by chance. The nutation is 4 millihertz, so the beat motion is just 4 millihertz, no? But in some cases, no, you can immediately understand where the nutation frequency close to the spin frequency, the frequency of the beat motion becomes very small, tending to zero. So it means that the period of the beat motion may become very, 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 very long. And we shall see. Not in this case. So here on the left, no, we have the angular rate with the nutation period. Is it correct? Ah, yes, nutation period is 4 millihertz, so the period is around 250 seconds. That's correct. Always pay attention, it's very easy to make. No, and so we have to verify, no, our simulation is coherent with this result. So the period is 250 seconds. Attitude, the spin period is shorter, 125 seconds. And so now you can see here the combination of spin period and of nutation period. The blue one is the third angle, and the period of the third angle, the spin motion, you see is just 125. But for the other two angles, now you see there are complicated, no, evolution, periodic of course, but because there is a combination of the two motions. And you see there is a period now, no, this is just the beat motion, which is very close now to the precession motion. So the beat motion is very close, the period is very close to the period of the beat motion. Flat cylinder now. Rate. Spin is always 8 millihertz, but now the nutation period is becoming close to the spin rate because we are close to the degenerate case. No, in the degenerate case, the two frequencies are equal. So it means that the beat motion has zero frequency, so infinite period. And infinite period then corresponds to instability. In this case, the beat motion is 0.8 millihertz, and so we have, no, a very long period, no, about 1 millihertz, so a period of about, no, 1,000 seconds. And you can see here, no, you see that at certain point, no, evolution of the phi angle, remember that the theta angle has no initial angular rate. So the effect is especially it's evident on the roll motion. And this, you see that at a certain time, the angular, the phi, the roll is becoming zero and then increases again and then become, these are the typical evolution of a beat motion due to the difference, not to oscillate, is oscillation that are very close together. This is typical then of the modulation modulation method and so on. But no, we can see also here, in since we have two oscillators then combined together. So one oscillator is exciting the other and then generates this type of motion. Just to conclude the combination of the attitude dynamics and of the kinematics and the attitude dynamics, no, we have just now to replace the spin motion with the angular rate of the orbit itself. We already saw this motion, no? Now we are combining with the attitude dynamics in order to obtain a perturbation equation, and this perturbation equation is very important because we will use this equation when we are introducing the so-called gravity gradient torque, no? The gravity gradient, just in the second part, the gravity gradient torque, no? Assume you have a slim or slender satellite orbiting, no? Like a pendulum, but now this pendulum is orthogonal to the local gravity, okay? Slim. What occurs? Can this attitude, no, with the main axis, assume this is the first axis, can the first axis be orthogonal, remain orthogonal to the local gravity? This is the question. If it not remains orthogonal, it means there is a torque that no, makes the satellite to rotate and to tend to align to the local gravity. And this is what occurs. But we have to understand which is the reason. Of course, if I have no, a pendulum, no, this is our local gravity, no, or my arm is here in this direction, no, after some times my arm of course, no, goes along the local gravity, no, because I am, no, I become tired, no, because I am contrasting the local gravity, but the control, no, of our body. So this is the pendulum equation, no, and oscillate, if there is a damping then aligns with the local gravity. But remember now in this equation, I forgot, but you can see immediately there is no damping. No damping. So if there is a torque that tends to align my satellite to the local gravity, actually there will be no alignment, but the satellite continues to rotate. No. This is the orbit plane. The local gravity is in the orbit plane, so it will continue to rotate, but we shall see there is not only a torque around this axis. Let me call this the pitch axis, but there are other torques also around the other axis. And the reason is why there is a torque. This is a very, no, why? Which is the reason? That's a very important reason. No, and the reason is that also along a very short body, maybe assume 5 meters, at an altitude maybe of 300 kilometers, but the radius of the Earth is 6 million meters, okay? So from the center, if we are considering the Earth as a point mass, is far, the radius is more than 6 million, pretty 7 million kilometers, 7 million meters, no? 7,000 kilometers, this is just 5 meters. So one thing is that the gravity field is uniform. It's not uniform. Because the gravity field direction, no? Assuming just the spherical term of the gravity, because we shall see there are other terms, is radially directed. So here is directed in this way, here is directed in this way. So there is a distribution of mass, and the variation of the gravity acceleration along this very short mass distribution generates a torque. This is called the gravity gradient torque. That's very important. It's one of the most important torque, especially when the orbit is low. Of course, as far as the orbit is becoming very high, no, then this torque is becoming faint. But when, as in the International Space Station or no, satellite or station that are very at a low Earth orbit, 300 kilometers around, then the gravity gradient torque is very important and must be contrasted. And the next exercise will be how to contrast this gravity gradient torque. So, but next, now rewrite the attitude equation, the overall attitude equation, assuming no, that the spin motion is not around up to now the spin motion was just a definition. Now our spin motion is the spin motion given by the orbit angular rate, to the fact that our satellite is no, rotating, okay, tangential to the, no, to the orbit path, and so there is a pitch motion which is used if the axis at orbit to the normal is called the second axis, y-axis, then the second axis, the spin rate will be defined along the second axis. As here, so now it's very important to consider also a perturbation of the spin motion, which is theta dot. And then, of course, no, be careful that now, no, the rows with the zero eigenvalues, no, the state, the angle, and the angular rate with zero eigenvalue is the second angle now, and the second angular rate. And so it's not difficult to find out, but this result was already shown in the attitude kinematics, so we have to modify the position of the angular rate terms in the state equation. But the properties of the state equation remain the same. So we have two eigenvalues equal to zero, and then we have four eigenvalues imaginary and equal. And two complex eigenvalue concerning the attitude kinematics and two other one concerning the dynamics. The value of omega zero, we shall see when studying the orbit, strictly depends on the altitude of the orbit. For orbit around 300 kilometers, omega zero is not very far. Well, is less than the values we used before, is about 1 milliradian per second. So it corresponds to the period of 1 hour and a half. So this is already the demonstration that we already did before, no? But let me remind, of course, we started from this equation, no? This is the other equation. Now we must pay attention also to the input, because if we want to add the gravity gradient torques or other torques, now we have to consider also the input term of the dynamic equation. In order here is possible also to this equation, no, in principle is rather complicated, but it's possible to, in general, this is a generic equation, okay? This is a generic equation. It's possible to define a new state which is exactly equal to A theta times omega, and then to divide omega by making the inverse of this new state variable. So in this case, which is different from the previous case, this is another way to obtain the same equation. In this case, no, the new equation is theta dot equal to omega theta. So we are pushing the eigenvalues of the, so we are making a transformation of the kinematic equation. The kinematic equation has now A, no, of the kinematics equal to zero. This is a simplification. Remember before, no? So there are several ways of building up the combination of the attitude and the dynamics. In this case, you see, no, this matrix is not equal to zero, but include, of course, omega sub home. Instead, in this case, we are capable of making the matrix A, and so, no, theta dot is equal to zero theta plus the I matrix omega theta. But now the problem, the complication comes to the dynamic equation, because in the dynamic equation we have to make the derivative of this angular rate, and the derivative of the angular rate, we have to make the derivative also of the matrix A of theta. That's the complication. But I want not to just to introduce actually, we can adopt a more simplified method. No, we start from the perturbation equation, the same equation can be obtained starting from this equation. No? And if we are using this equation, we can define, no, omega theta, omega is this, phi dot plus omega zero psi, go to the original equation, no? Phi dot, okay, is equal to omega, no, that now this is a state equation, but we have to the state equation, this is multiplied times omega, this is omega x, and this is omega minus omega zero times the third state variable, so omega zero psi. The second is theta plus omega sub o, and the third one is psi dot minus omega zero phi. And so now we can, no, instead of considering omega as a state, we can define omega theta, then theta dot is equal to omega minus this value, and this corresponds to the transformation of from the orbit to the body frame. And so omega dot now is nothing else than the derivatives of second derivative of phi, omega 0 psi dot, theta, the second derivative of theta, the second derivative of psi, minus omega 0 phi dot. So the equation now, okay, using this trasformation, we are simplifying this state matrix. The angular rate of the orbit now was shifted from the kinematic to the dynamics in this way. No, because it's this term, this one and this one. And this is a simply, the equation is the same, but the kinematic now is just a kinematic of three simple integrators. Instead, omega O and the nutation rate are entering into the dynamic equation, and this is the new state equation. This is a simplified way of writing the state equation, the combination of the attitude dynamics and the attitude kinematics. You see now here, no, if I am considering alone, be careful, the kinematic, the eigenvalues are zero, but actually the eigenvalues are not zero, because you see there is this interaction between the dynamics and the attitude kinematics. This equation will be, is better to use this in this form when we are entering other, also the torques. Because the torques, the gravity gradient, we shall see, modify these terms. So, just for concluding, we saw two methods for building up, combining the perturbed attitude and dynamic equation. The first one is to write the perturbed equation, no, of the attitude and the perturbed equation of the dynamics. Then, in this case, when the equilibrium is a spin motion around any axis, but principal axis, then we have immediately, no, you see we have an upper triangular matrix, so we can immediately see the eigenvalues, because we have the three eigenvalues of the attitude kinematics in this matrix, and then we have the eigenvalues of the dynamics in this other matrix, and then they are connected through a matrix I. Sub 3, clear? This is the first method. But for reason not to be seen when introducing the torques, it's better to modify this equation. To modify this equation, we are defining a new angular rate. So the new state, of course, the attitude perturbation remains the same, but we have to modify the angular rate. Of course, the eigenvalue should remain the same, which is the principle. Which is the principle? The principle is the state transformation. You know that any state variable can be transformed in infinite way. So usually, this is the difficulty of state equation. When building state equation, you have always to think which is the best selection of state variables. For certain analysis and computation, no, this selection of state variable is not the best one. So we make a transformation. This is the generic transformation, no? We define, no, omega theta, a new angular rate, as A of theta times omega. So in principle, omega theta is just theta dot, okay? So the Euler angular rate, which is not Euler angular rate, remember, are not state variable. The state variable are the body component of the angular rate. Okay? So now we are using a state variable, second set of state variable, the Euler angular rate. This, of course, modifies the dynamic equation. No? And in our case, it's not difficult to obtain the transformation. And now be careful, no? In the dynamic equation remains the same here, but we have to add this term, of course. Writing the state matrix, the B matrix remains the same, the input matrix remains the same. The modification now is this, the state matrix is no more upper triangular. So it means that now it's more complicated to compute the eigenvalues, but the eigenvalue should remain the same. And you should verify that the eigenvalue remain the same. But now, no, all the angular, the spin rate and the nutation rate terms are entering just the dynamic equation. So we can now make the break. And then 10 minutes we can start again. In the second part of this morning, we are introducing the environment torques. There are different types of environment torques. The first torque is very important, is the due to the non-uniform Earth's gravitational field on an extended body. And this torque will be called the gravity gradient torque, and this is significant at low Earth orbits. The second type of torques are the torques due to the electromagnetic waves from the sun hitting the surface, and the torques become significant if the center of pressure of the electromagnetic waves is different from the center of mass. A torque not due to the electromagnetic waves coming from the sun, but due to the atmosphere, are the aerodynamic torques. Magnetic wave torques always exist because is due to the sun. The aerodynamic torque becomes significant only at low Earth orbits and is due to the atmosphere molecule hitting the surface of the spacecraft. Then there are other minor torques, like also the planet electromagnetic waves, no, the planet electromagnetic field interacting with the spacecraft electrical dipole. Also, this is important for the at low Earth orbit. And we shall use this torque, no, in order to dump the gravity gradient torque. Then there are other minor torques like radiated electromagnetic waves from antenna, radiation, and so on, and of course micrometeorites impact. But no, we are focusing in our simulation, we are focusing on this one. This one and this one. This morning we are concentrating on the gravity gradient torques. Let me make a very generic introduction, no? We are considering now an element of mass. And on this mass, of course, there is the gravity force directed toward the Earth's center. so the local gravity, along the local gravity, and so we have to build up the moment of this force, and the moment of this force is obtained by integrating, no, the elementary moments, no, along all the volume of the spacecraft. In order to do this, we must put in evidence, and this is the reason why there is a torque, we have to put in evidence that the gravity force or the gravity acceleration is not the same at any point. What means? And this is the complicated expression, no? Remember that the gravity acceleration is a vector. So, what we have to do? We have to make a series expansion of this vector. But to make a series expansion of a vector, we have to introduce the Jacobian matrix of this vector. And the Jacobian matrix is a matrix, which in this case is symmetric, and is called the, now here is in still in a vectorial form, but then we can represent the coordinates, the entries of this matrix in the body frame, no? And of course, this matrix will enter into our formulation. This matrix is called the gravity tensor matrix. And this matrix accounts for the fact that the gravity acceleration is not constant. Actually, magnitude is constant, be careful. What is not constant is the direction. And this very small deviation accounts for torques due to the gravity gradient. Gravity gradient means that the gravity acceleration is not uniform along the points of the body. Of course, this expansion of the gravity acceleration is just a first order expansion, and there are, of course, second order terms we are neglecting. So, in terms of body coordinate, then we have to write the coordinate of the torque, m sub g, which is equal now, no? By using this expansion, we can introduce this expansion into the integral. Now, you see, the first term of the expansion is computed in the center of mass of the satellite, so it is a constant. This is a constant. This vector, the coordinate are constant. So, remember that the integral of S times dm is zero, so this term disappears. It remains only this term. And this term is can be written in this form, cross product of S times the tensor times S dm. And this expression is very similar to the expression we found when computing the inertia moment. No? So at the end, we have this expression. This is a rather complicated expression, but we can simplify this expression. So the generic form of the gravity gradient torque, no, depends on the moment of inertia and on the expression of the tensor. Of course, be careful, the expression of the tensor, since depends on the shape of the body, will account also for the coordinate of the body. And now we shall see how to simplify this expression in some case, very simple case. So, assume that the gravity only contains the so-called spherical terms. What means? That we assume that the gravity field and the gravity acceleration is due to a mass concentrated in the center of mass of the Earth. In this case, the gravity field, no, is just as a form of a sphere, no, and then in the space, and so we can write, this is the expression of the gravity acceleration vector, then we have minus times a scale factor and times the direction of the radius. The radius is directed from the center of the Earth to the center of mass of the body. And this is called R sub C. And this R sub C will be expressed in terms of body coordinates. No? Let me call the coordinate of this unit. This is a unit vector because you see it's divided time the magnitude. And let me call this coordinate x sub c, y sub c, z sub c. This is a unit vector. Be careful. Now, the scale factor is the standard expression of the less the minus sign of the gravity acceleration. The gravity acceleration is due to this constant, which is typical of the Earth, mu sub e, mu sub b, go to c, but we'll see later when treating the orbit, is just the gravitational constant times the mass of the Earth. Just to remember how the gravity acceleration is obtained, to be complete, no? The gravity acceleration, now be careful about the signs, because sometimes it's defined with a sign, otherwise without. Here is without any sign, is the, in turn, the gravity acceleration, since it is a vector, it is the gradient of the gravity field. The gravity field here is P sub G, and the gravity field is just the gravitational constant divide radius. So the gravity field, no, is just in the space, no, a hyperbolic expression. And now, if we take the gradient of this term, be careful, it's not immediate gradient, be careful, because R sub C is the magnitude. So R sub C is the square of R sub C, inner product, scalar product R sub C. No? So we have to make minus ME divided the square with the minus sign, and then we have to compute the gradient of the scalar. And the gradient of the scalar then provides the direction of the gravity field. No, indeed, you see here we have 1/2, and then we have RC at the numerator divided the square of the scalar product, no? And so this is again R, and so we have RC divided R, and this is the unit vector of the gravity acceleration. Here there are also some subtleties. In principle, a gradient should be written as a rho, but forget now this. But in principle, this is the correct way of it. Now we have to compute the tensor. So the tensor is the gradient of the acceleration vector, no? And now there is all the computation. So this is the original expression, and this is now we have, be careful, no? Different terms, two terms, no? The first one, we have to consider the derivative with respect to the cube on the denominator. So this becomes R sub C elevated to 6 times RC remains, and then we have again to build up the obtained gradient of R sub C scalar product R sub C under the square root minus, this is simple, the gradient of R sub C. No? And at the end we obtain this expression, and this is the final expression of the gravity tensor in the case of a point mass. And so now, using this expression, we can build up now this final expression of the gravity of the gravity. This is a matrix, of course, it's a symmetric matrix. You see here there is again the dyad. Now we also the dyad was in several we saw several times in the Rodriguez form, in the moment of inertia and so on, minus the identity times the square of the radius divided 3. At the end we obtain this cross product, which is the very simple form, and now we can understand the properties of the gravity gradient torque. No? So you see there is this term 3 times mu sub e divided rc cube, no? So the gravity acceleration diminishes with the square of the radius, okay? The gravity acceleration. The gravity torque, because there is the gravity tensor, diminishes with the cube of the radius, which is correct. And the gravity field, no, decreases with the radius itself. So radius, square of the radius, cube of the radius. And then we have to build up the direction of the gravity torque. The direction of the gravity torque is just the cross product of the radius, no? Cross product with the radius pre-multiplied by the inertia tensor. So the direction accounts for the shape of the body, which is reasonable. The moment of inertia, no, accounts for the shape of the body. You immediately see from this expression that if the shape of the body is spherical, which means that the inertia tensor is a diagonal and the elements of the diagonal are equal, then this matrix can be factorized outside this cross product, and this cross product provides zero. So a spherical body has no gravity gradient torque. That's a very important result. If we assume principal axis, or another property is very easy, that the gravity gradient torque is in the plane orthogonal to the radius, no? So the components are in the plane orthogonal to the radius. In the case of principal axis, the expression greatly simplifies. Now we can introduce also the component of the direction, and we have just to compute this cross product vector. This is a good simple exercise for you. So we have this expression, 3 times the gravitational constant of the Earth divide the radius elevated to the fifth power. But be careful now. No, excuse me, sir. I made a mistake before. No, this is not correct. This is are just the components of R sub C, because now they are used as the components of R sub C. I'm sorry. This is an error to be corrected. So X sub C, Y sub C, and Z sub C are the components of the radius. Okay, and now look this equation, of course. You see, these are the components of the, no, there are cross product, and then is divided, is not more the cube of the radius, but the fifth power, because actually, no, we could split this is in the cube, and then here divided to the square, then x sub c divided r, sub c, then of course is a unit, is the component of the unit vector. I'm sorry. So this is a very simple equation, but this is not the final equation. Why? Because we do not know the expression of the component of the radius in the body frame. Now, which will be the expression of the components of the radius in the body frame? No? The radius, remember, is one axis. Remember the local, vertical, local, horizontal frame of the orbit that we introduced also when we made the first exercise. No? The radius, no? Is one axis of the local, vertical, local, horizontal frame. Of course, it's not inertial, okay? But is the axis defined by the orbit, not by the body, no? So the radius is defined by the orbit. So the components, so if, no, in the local vertical, local horizontal frame, which is the coordinate of the radius, zero. If the, remember that the radius in the local vertical, local horizontal frame is the third axis, so the radius is zero, zero, r sub c. But of course, these are not the coordinate in the body frame. Why? Because the body frame axis will be in general misaligned with respect to the local vertical, local horizontal frames. It's clear? And the attitude control goal is, for instance, to keep the body frame axis aligned with the local vertical, local horizontal frame. But of course, not any control cannot bring the error to zero, so we have to account for a misalignment, and this misalignment is represented by the Euler angles or by the quaternion. Now, assuming that the misalignment is very small, we are representing the misalignment through the Euler angles. It's clear? So it means that the coordinates x sub c and so on will contain as a factor the radius, the magnitude of the radius r sub c, times, no, an expression of the Euler angles. Of course, this expression can be very complicated, but not excessive. If we are considering that the angles are generic, no? Adopt, this is the standard sequence 3 to 1. Remember, this is the matrix from the body, the transformation from body to inertial, but in our, no, this is not inertial. L is the local, vertical, local, horizontal frame. No, so this is the radius here. Okay, or instead of r sub c, I introduce the symbol A. The symbol A is a symbol used for the radius of the orbit. Actually, we shall see that A is the symbol used for the so-called semi-major axis of the orbit. When the orbit is a circle, assume the orbit is a circle, A is the radius of the orbit. So this is standard symbol in the orbit. And in red, you see, there is the body frame, which is misaligned with respect to the local vertical, local horizontal frame. So if, no, we express the radius in the local vertical, local horizontal frame as 0, 0, A, Now we have be careful to apply the, this is in the local vertical, so we have to apply the inverse transformation, so the transformation from LV, LH to body, which is the transpose of this matrix, and in the end we obtain this expression. And you see that this expression, no? Now we have to take this expression and introduce into the equation of the torque, no? Now, here you see there will be a product of sine and cosine, no? And it's possible to replace the product of sine and cosine with the sine of 2 phi and so on. So this is the reason why here there is, this is divided times 2. Be careful. So this is the expression, having made the computations of the, so summarizing, this is the expression of the gravity gradient torque, assuming principal axis, and of course you see if the sphere, if the satellite is spherical, this is becoming zero because the difference between the inertia moment, of course, are zero, no? And then we have the expression of the, depending on the Euler angles, and this is non-linear expression, periodic expression in terms of the angle. And this is the expression in the large for arbitrary angle, Euler angles. If we assume that there is an attitude control that is capable of keeping the Euler angle small, then we can replace, no, the trigonometric expression with the linear expression. In this case, you see here there is the sine of 2 phi and there is the cosine of theta as a first element, and then we have just the phi times 2 divided 2 to disappear and remains phi. So the first torque is proportional to the roll. Okay? The torque on the first axis is proportional to the roll. Of course, be careful, the sign depends on the value of the inertia moment. So maybe positive, negative sign. The second depends on theta. No? Now, of course, these torques then will depend how the inertia moment, which value have the inertia moment. Look, the third component, and this is pretty reasonable, is zero. Of course, it's not zero, be careful. This is not zero, but it's second order. Why it is second order? Because, remember, the torque, no, is orthogonal to the radius. But now we are just considering a small misalignment of the body frame with respect to the radius. So, of course, it means that the torque, no, on the third axis is a second order and not first order. So the two first order torques are the torques aligned the horizontal axis, the two horizontal axis. X-axis directed along the along the orbit, and the second axis directed orthogonal to the orbit, assuming that the angle are small. Of course, if the angle are greater, the Euler angle are greater, then the body frames are completely misaligned with respect to the local vertical, local horizontal axis. These, for instance, are the inertia moment of a European satellite. Now, satellite is GOC. GOC means gravity, field, and ocean, and steady state ocean circulation explorer. This was a satellite that built up the gravity field of the Earth in a very accurate way. Was a very slender satellite, 5 meter long, no? And the control, the attitude control, should kept the x-axis, no? Tangent to the orbit. Of course, there was an attitude control, no? That was capable of doing this. So, in practice, was close to be cylindric because the second inertia moment, no, along the axis orthogonal to the orbit of the satellite was polar, no, close to be polar, because, no, when the satellite, no, was on the orbit, the Earth was rotating, no, below the orbits, and though the satellite could scan all the Earth's surface in order to measure the gravity. The third axis very close, no, and the first axis, no, the inertia moment around the axis, the first axis very small, no, less than 1/10. The omega sub-zero, the omega sub-zero is, no, I forgot to say, is just mu sub-e divided a. This is square. Actually, this is, we have to. Cube, no? And this is the angular, excuse, this is before, no? Let me see here, no? This has been defined here, but come back, I'm sorry, I forgot to say. You see here there is mu sub e divided the cube of the radius, so if this radius is pretty constant, then we have a constant angular rate. This is an exercise for you to demonstrate that this ratio corresponds to an angular rate, the square of the angular rate, so radius, radian, divided, square second. Yes, square second, of course, because is the square of an angular rate. And this has been denoted with omega sub o, the orbit, squared. So omega sub o is just the angular rate of the orbit. And the general expression of omega sub o is this, the Earth's gravitational constant divided the cube of the semi-major axis of the orbit squared. So when you know the semi-major axis, no? And the semi-major axis is the equatorial axis, the equatorial length of the Earth, which is about 6 million meter plus something, 6 million and 300, 6 million and 3,100 meter, plus the altitude of the orbit, in this case about 250 kilometers, so at the end 6.7, 10 elevated to 6 meter, and this provide omega zero about 1 milliradian per second, corresponding to a period of 1 hour and a half, more or less. So in this case you see that the torques are very small. No, the order of magnitude of the torques are millinewton per meter, millinewton meter, very small, but they are not small for a satellite, because the satellite is in the space. Torques of this kind, if they are not compensated by the attitude control, makes the satellite to tumble, and then you are losing the satellite. And it's very difficult to re-obtain the attitude to make the satellite under control. Because, for instance, the problem is the problem of the antenna, no? In order to recover the satellite attitude, you have to transmit some data from ground. If the antenna is not capable of transmitting data or receiving data from ground, the satellite is lost. So you see, around the first axis is very small because J2 and J3 are pretty equal, so is zero, there is no roll torque. Around the third axis, the factor of the torque is not small, but this is a second order torque. So if theta and phi are small, no, also this torque is becoming small. Instead, the very important torque is the second one, the pitch torque, which is reasonable. This is a pendulum, no? This is the gravity gradient. What is doing? Is trying, since the pitch torque, no, is perpendicular to the orbit plane, the gravity gradient is trying to align the satellite to the local gravity as a pendulum, as a normal pendulum. The problem is that there is no damping, so of course the satellite is rotating, and when the angles are becoming larger, the Euler angle, then also the other torques, no? The third torque is becoming larger because there is the pitch angle that is large, and so on. Now there is also the yaw torque, so it's not rotating now in this way, but it's rotating also in this way, and of course this is called the tumbling of a satellite. So now we can understand how to introduce the gravity gradient torque in the state equations. So we saw, now we are considering just perturbations, we are remaining into linear and time invariant equations, no? Otherwise the equations are becoming non-linear, and so they are not easy to be solved. You need a numerical integration, no? That we have in our hands. So we are assuming, of course, that the equilibrium is a spin equilibrium, no? Spin around the principal axis. Since now we are introducing the gravity gradient, it's better to assume that the spin axis is the spin, is the angular rate of the orbit, so it is the second axis, the spin axis, no? And omega sub zero is exactly, no, mu, the square root of mu sub e divided the cube of the semi-major axis. Remember the definition of the three factors sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3. Now, so we are assuming a perturbation around the attitude equilibrium. So remember the attitude equilibrium now, for what concern the angle phi and psi is zero, but for co concern the angle theta, no, is of course the No, what means, no, just to see, no? The equilibrium of the attitude is that the body frame is rotating around the orbit normal, okay? So the body frame is not remains inertial as an equilibrium, but is rotating around the orbit normal. So, no, no, the second axis as an equilibrium remains inertial and the other two axes, no, x and z are rotating, no, with the angular rate omega sub o. So now we have to express, no, the perturbation of the gravity gradient torque we already computed, no, and the expression is this one, where you see we can introduce the factor sigma 1 and sigma 2. And you see that this expression is not proportional to the angular the Euler angle phi theta times the square of omega of the spin angular rate. And so now we have to complete this equation. Remember, for this reason, no, now I hope it is clear the reason why we modified, we made the transformation, we modified the matrix A in order to have the spin parameter, the spin coefficient, no, proportional to omega sub 3 in the dynamic equation, because now we have, no, a term due to the gravity gradient depending on the attitude that enters the dynamic equation. So it's better to have all together. And indeed, no, in the next page, I recall the original state matrix, no? Here is the matrix, the submatrix coming from the gyro torque, and this is the submatrix coming from the spin motion, okay, from the kinematic equation. Now we have to add the terms due to the gravity gradient. This term remains the same because the gravity gradient has no component at first order around the third axis. But there are, you see now, here was zero. Now there is a term on this diagonal, which is due to the gravity gradient component along the pitch axis, the second axis. And then also these terms modifies. And now the equation, no, the state matrix is becoming more complicated than before. This equation was studied in the 19th century by Lagrange. Okay? So the problem now, the stability of this equation is well known. Okay? Now we have to study the stability of this equation. But come back to see. Notwithstanding the modification, the introduction of this term, the equation, the state matrix, all the matrix, remains decoupled between pitch motion, no? But now be careful, pitch motion will have a new eigenvalue because, no, there is this term. So before the pitch motion had just zero to zero eigenvalues, a cascade of two integrator. Now we have also the eigenvalues will change. But the pitch motion is still decoupled from the other two motions. And so we can split our equation, no, if we're just considering the autonomous equation, so the free response, in these two ways. But to study the stability according to Lyapunov, so the free response stability, no, we just need the autonomous equation. We can forget any output, any input. In any case, the input is already gravity gradient. But what is doing the gravity gradient? The gravity gradient is depending on the attitude and so is introducing a feedback into the state equation. The question is, the state feedback introduced by the gravity gradient makes keeps the equation, the original, the complete, the new equation stable or not unstable? That's a question. It's clear the problem? So, now, start from the second. This is an equation, no? Now, is an oscillator. Also, the pitch motion is an oscillator. Indeed, no? Here you have, no? If you compute the, no? Characteristic equation, plus 3 omega 0 sigma 2 equals 0. So, in order that this equation is stable, sigma 2 must be positive, omega 0 square is positive, omega o square is positive, so sigma 2 must be positive, no? So sigma 2 is J1 minus J3 divided J2, no? In the case, of course, of Gauche, in the case of Gauche, J1 is much less than J3, so less than 0, and so it is unstable. In order this equation is stable, you need that J1 is greater than J3. Gauche, remember J1 equal to 150, J3 equal to 2000, more than 2000, so it is unstable. It is reasonable. Because, be careful, the equilibrium here is assumed that the body frame is aligned with the local vertical, local horizontal frame, but the gravity gradient is trying to rotate in order to find out another equilibrium. So the equation, since we are considering the perturbation equation, we are just considering the perturbation around the equilibrium. We cannot say which will be the new equilibrium, because this is a linear equation. The linear equation has only one equilibrium point. The nonlinear, in order to study the new equilibrium, we have to study to find out the equilibrium of the nonlinear equation. But start just restrict to the linear equations. Okay? So if sigma 2 is greater than 0, then it is stable. And this is a very is a condition, is a first condition, J1 greater than J3. Now we have to see the condition of the other four equations. This is more complicated. This study was made, as I mentioned before, by Lagrange. So we are arriving at the now I don't know if follow all the derivations. Here we have a fourth order polynomial, of course, but it's possible to, you see, to give a close form to the roots of this polynomial. That's good. No, but you see we have four roots because there is a plus minus here, plus minus here. And so it's possible to find out necessary and sufficient condition to obtain purely imaginary roots. Be careful that our stability here is just to find out imaginary roots. There is no damping. So we cannot find out roots in the left hand plane because there is no damping. The energy, of course, is potential energy and kinetic energy. Potential energy given by the gravity and kinetic energy given by the initial conditions, the angular rate of the spacecraft. No? So stability means look for purely imaginary roots. If the roots are not purely imaginary, There will be one root with negative real part and one root with positive real part, that means instability. No? So it's possible to obtain some conditions, and the conditions are of this kind. So we have J1 greater than J3, and at the end J2 greater than J1 greater than J3. This is the one of the Lagrange conditions. And in terms of sigma 1 and sigma 3, this is the region we can find out this region. But now I don't want to enter all the details. What means this? It means that it's possible to forget for a moment the problem of the damping, because of course we need a damp to reduce as much as possible the oscillation. Okay? But it's possible there are conditions in which by providing, no, the correct moment of inertia to the spacecraft around the principal axis, in this case J2, no, is the moment of inertia around the pitch axis, J1 around the horizontal axis, and J3 around the local gravity axis. Now, this should be the smallest moment of inertia. So there are conditions, and these conditions were known, no? And were used in the no? Consider just that J3, assume that J3, no, should be the smallest, which means which should be the form of the satellite. No? Should be like the gocce, like a cylinder, a slim, slender cylinder, but aligned with the local vertical. No? So the satellite should be like this. In this case, the moment of inertia around the third axis is the minimum moment of inertia. The moment of inertia around the two horizontal axes are larger than J3, and this is reasonable because in this case, no, the spacecraft is aligned along the local vertical, and in principle, no, the torque, the gravity gradient torque are smaller, and just they will not make the spacecraft attitude, no, become farther from the, no, they are just oscillating, no, around the local gravity. So this is something reasonable, and indeed this was the technology, one of very important technology in the early times. Now there is also another region here, but okay, these are just second order approximation, no? So unfortunately it's not immediate to build up a satellite having these properties, having this moment of inertia, because the moment of inertia of a satellite depends how the satellite is launched, which are the distribution of the mass, and so on. So there was a method, no? The so-called boom method, no? The satellite contains some either rods or masses connected to some rope, and when the satellite was in orbit, this rod, boom, or this rope with the masses were launched outside the satellite in order to provide the correct moment of inertia around the three axes. And this is the, no, the condition in order to satisfy the Lagrange equation. No, indeed, the rod along the third axis should be longer, because the moment of inertia should be the smaller. So it is the opposite, no? L sub 3 greater than L sub 1 greater than L sub 2. This is the one saw, it seems, the Salyut space station, no? The Salyut space station was Soviet space station, was not continuously lived, but sometimes they abandoned, no? And then to come again later. No, this one, this was one of the first space stations, and when it was abandoned, no, it was rotated in order to have the minimum inertia axis aligned with the local gravity, as in this case, in order to provide the satellite passive. Of course, the space station contained also some damper in order to reduce the oscillation, and it remain with a stable attitude, no, until no, the crew came again to live in the space station. So, in the next lesson, now we have no time, and this will be the next exercise, okay? Just to make, give an introduction. So, at first time, we assume that our spacecraft is aligned with the local vertical, no? With the minimum inertia axis, but of course, if there are perturbations of the angular rate, this perturbation will make the satellite, no, rotating around the three axes. And so we shall see, no, oscillations. Okay, this is already, this is the torque, but already damped. You see that it's damped, no? The torque is, but without, of course, the damper, the torque is oscillating without damping. So the problem is to make this torque to damp, no? The original, the early way to do this was to mount a damper. Which is a damper? A damper is just a rotating body which rotates inside the fluid. And if it rotates inside the fluid, of course, there is a viscous torque, and this viscous torque is reducing the kinetic energy around the axis to which the rotating body is aligned. So we, if we want to, no, dump the, we start from doing this, we just consider one damper aligned with the pitch axis, and we want to dump the gravity gradient torque around the pitch axis. Okay? These are the equation. Of course, we must be careful that we have to add the dynamics of the body. There is the body is another body that rotates inside the satellite. So we have to add the state equation of the body, no? And we shall see that the capability of damping of this body is very limited, very, very limited, but it was used in the early times. And we shall study also the dynamics and the eigenvalues, no? Actually, this the presence of this body, what is doing? Is adding a feedback, no? From the angular rate of the spacecraft, that will be a dynamic feedback, because there is a body which is rotating, a dynamic feedback to the input. We shall see that unfortunately the capabilities of damping of this dynamic feedback are very limited because of the transfer function that this dynamic feedback generates. This is a hardware way of damping, is a hardware damper. In modern time, this problem do not exist because there are sophisticated attitude controls that automatically cancel, no, eliminate, reject any disturbance, and I will explain how to do this, no? They eliminate any external torques, independent if there is gravity gradient, no problem at all. But a second method is to, as an intermediate way to the modern way, is to use another phenomenon generating torques. In this case, a phenomenon that allows us to introduce a common torque on the spacecraft. And this phenomenon is the coupling of a solenoid on the spacecraft where there is current, so with a magnetic dipole on the spacecraft with the Earth's magnetic field. And unfortunately, also this method is not completely, is not efficient in the general way because, and we shall study, it's not difficult to imagine. If I have a solenoid, no, with the current, so with some flux defined by the current, is a vector, the torque generated by this dipole, try to review this concept, via electricity, no? The torque generated by this dipole, no? Is a magnetic dipole because there are flux lines, okay, inside the solenoid, with the Earth's magnetic dipole is the cross product of two arms. So it means that the available torque is just, of course, orthogonal to the Earth's magnetic field. If I am generating a torque that is orthogonal to another vector, in principle I have just two components of a torque, not three components. So I cannot generate an arbitrary torque. The torque is decided at each time by the direction of the gravity field. Luckily, okay, when the Earth's gravity field is constant and when it is varying. If I have an equatorial orbit, this is constant because the gravity field is all is give is directed from yes, south to north, okay? And it's constant all along the equatorial orbit. So with the equatorial orbit, I have just two components orthogonal to the Earth's rotation axis. So I cannot generate a common torque along the Earth's rotation axis, only in the orthogonal plane. But if I have a polar orbit, this is not true because the Earth's magnetic dipole, no, is rotating as soon as I from the equator is directed in this way, and when I'm going to the pole, is the opposite way, no? Because the flux lines are closing each other, closing, no? From the equator to the North Pole, to the South Pole, and so on. So luckily, I'm lucky, but I need to have a polar orbit or close to a polar orbit, then I can modify the direction of my torques, no, when the satellite is rotating all around the Earth. But also in the case of a polar orbit, we shall see that it's not possible. We want to generate a torque, for instance, that is aligned, it is orthogonal to the orbit. No? If the orbit is polar, I want to generate a torque orthogonal to the orbit to dump the pitch torque is orthogonal to the orbit plane. But this is not exactly possible. Why? Because the Earth's magnetic field is not aligned with the North Pole. The magnetic pole is slightly shifted from the North Pole. So there will be always some component, some component of torque that is not wanted. And so we shall see, we'll generate other problems. That's very interesting, no, to understand the limitation of the magnetic field control. But of course, this magnetic field control just requires to put very simple solenoid on the spacecraft, and it is widely used today in order to make attitude control of the spacecraft, and we shall use it to dump the gravity gradient. Okay, so next time on Wednesday afternoon, thank you very much.